Okay, thank you. Thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation to speak at this workshop again. 2 years ago, I spoke about elliptic periodic orbits and dynamical convexity. This year, I speak about multiplicity of periodic orbits and dynamical convexity. In both situations, this is joint work with Leonardo Macarini. And if I had to put a percentage like yesterday, probably it's 9/10 Leonardo, and I just happen to come so often to Rio, and he comes so often to Lisbon, and we like so much to work together that I just happen to come along whatever he's thinking when I'm with him. So thank you very much to him for that. And but I'll do my best, but Leonardo is here, so if something really complicated you feel that you should ask, you get the picture. Okay, so let me start with an introduction. So we'll be dealing with contact manifolds. My contact manifolds, we have dimension 2n plus 1, contact structure xi, given by the kernel of a one-form alpha, and being a contact form, we know that alpha wedge d alpha to the n is a volume form. The main examples that I will be interested are, have all been already considered in this conference, star-shaped hypersurfaces in R2n plus 2. Unit cosphere bundles of Riemannian manifolds. And also prequantizations of integral symplectic manifolds. When you have a contact form, you also have a Rebbe vector field. We'll denote it by R alpha. It's characterized by being in the kernel of the alpha and normalized so that the contact form evaluated on R alpha is 1. Having a Rebbe vector field, you can integrate it and you get the Rebbe flow. Examples of this, directly associated with this, 3 examples. So if your hypersurface in R2n plus 2 is the level set of some Hamiltonian function, then of course the Rebbe flow is just a reparameterization of the Hamiltonian flow, and Rebbe orbits are just the same thing as Hamiltonian orbits, up to some reparameterization. The second example of unit cosphere bundles give rise to geodesic flows. And here, Rebbe orbits are geodesics. And when you have a prequantization, one example of an action, of course, is the S1 action on the fibers of the prequantization. These are all examples of Rebbe flows. And the problem that will be the main focus of this talk is the problem of finding some information about the number of simple closed Rebbe orbits in each of these examples. So that number throughout the talk will be just denoted by this symbol, sharp. Sharp will always denote the number of simple closed Rebbe orbits in a particular example. So we've already had several talks in this workshop dealing with this type of problem. And in some form or another, it has been mentioned what I will here call the contact Conley conjecture. That I'll abbreviate for by CCC, which which is due, for example, Ginsburg, Gurel, already mentioned it, other people who are also have said things about it. And let's say that it says the following. Under appropriate conditions, whatever those are, we should have that sharp is infinity. So there should exist infinitely many closed Reb orbits. And a theorem in that direction. Thank you, Victor. Sorry, Leonardo. Anyway, but a theorem in that direction, which is actually due to Drozd 3, is the following. Suppose you have a pre-quantization of some integral symplectic manifold B omega, and such that, and here are the appropriate conditions in these situations, and those appropriate conditions are the first Chern class of the contact distribution restricted to the second homology of your manifold should be zero, that omega restricted, the base should be a spherical. And also, with torsion-free fundamental group, then all, and let's say another condition here, index admissible, and I'll talk about the index in a moment, Reb flows satisfy that contact Conley conjecture. Okay, so here is a theorem in the spirit of this conjecture. So a note is that this is certainly not true when the base is not a spherical. So this condition, if not the others, is certainly fundamental, which is clearly shown by the fact that there exist irrational ellipsoids which fit nicely in the rest of the conditions of the theorem, since they arise as pre-quantizations of a base symplectic manifold, which is CPN. So in the non-spherical case, we cannot expect to have so easily infinitely many closed Reb orbits. And so a theorem that I am actually going to write here and leave it for a while. In the non-spherical situation, is the following. It has two parts. The first, due to Eklund and Hofer, and deals with the, so I have to be careful. I want to put this here. So suppose you have, again, a convex hypersurface in R to n plus 2, hence diffeomorphic to a sphere, then you can say that the number of closed periodic orbits is always greater or equal than 2. There is no, this might be, the flow might be degenerate flow. If you impose non-degeneracy, a result of Long and Zhu, says that if also non-degenerate, then this number is certainly greater or equal than n plus 1. OK. And this result, or these two results, set up the goal of our work that I'm presenting in this talk, which would be to understand and possibly generalize this, and this is this, using contact homology and the notion of dynamical convexity that I will explain. So that's the goal. OK, so let's now explain, say something about the Conways and their index and contact homology, which are ingredients that I'll need to present our results. So I will try to define what is the Conway's and their index, but I will assume for that, just for the purpose of the definition, let me suppose that the contact structure is trivial. So it has a global trivialization. Trivial in this sense, that has a global trivialization. So there is a trivialization of the contact structure. Then, using this trivialization, the linearization of the rib flow, of the rev flow, along a periodic orbit gamma, gives a path of linear symplectic maps acting on these R to n. A path starting at the identity of linear symplectic maps. And inside the linear symplectic group, there is a codimension 1 stratified space, which is called the Maslow cycle. The Maslow cycle M, which is the set of all symplectic matrices that have one in its spectrum, so this is a codimension 1 stratified submanifold. of this linear sympathetic group, and one can define the Kohn-Lenzander index of a periodic Rebb orbit as the intersection defined in a suitable way of this linear sympathetic path with this quad-dimension one Maslow cycle. And this is, in general, an integer number. Okay, so that's one of the ingredients. And then the ingredients, very briefly, for contact homology are the action functional on the loop space, well, I don't know, is this an explanation? So the action functional, which is just the integral of the contact form along an orbit, a closed rib orbit, and it's a function on the loop space of your manifold, and contact homology can be thought of as a Morse homology for this action functional. And what happens when you set it up like this is that the closed Rebb orbits are the critical points of this action functional, and so generate a chain complex, which is graded by the Kohn-Lenzander index, one can construct a differential on this complex, which counts certain pseudo-holomorphic cylinders. So I'm just talking here about cylindrical contact homology, pseudo-holomorphic cylinders, pseudo-holomorphic with respect to some auxiliary appropriate complex structures. And this happens in the symplectization of the contact manifold. And then it turns out that the homology that one gets out of this complex and differential is, in good cases, independent of the choices, the contact form, the auxiliary complex structure, and is just an invariant of the contact structure xi. Okay, so this is just necessarily very short description of the Kohn-Lenzander index and contact homology. The next thing I need is to define what we consider to be dynamical convexity. And so let me just start by the original definition, which was made for S3 by Hoffer. Wisocki and Zender more than 15 years ago, precisely, I think, 1998. And they say that a contact form alpha on the three sphere is said to be dynamically convex if the Kohn-Lenzander index of any of its closed Rebb orbits is always greater or equal than 3. So they proved a bunch of remarkable results in that in the paper I'm referring to, but in particular, one such result, which I think Otto just referred as a lemma, but here it gains the status of a theorem, is that any convex S3 is dynamically convex. So dynamical convexity, in the sense of these definitions, generalizes the definition of usual convexity. And some notes I'd like to add to this fact is, the first is that it generalizes, in a very nice way, because this is something which is invariant by contact homomorphisms, while convexity of S3 in R4 is not invariant by simplex homomorphisms on R4. So you get a notion which is intrinsically invariant by contact homomorphisms. Second thing, second note, is that the proof of Hofer, Vysotsky, and Zender also shows similar result for any sphere, any convex sphere. Also shows that every closed rib orbit gamma on a convex sphere in R2n+2, on a convex, very important, sphere in R2n+2 satisfies that its Conley-Zender index is greater or equal than n+2. So that's the generalization of these in higher dimensions. But this turns out this number n+2 has a nice interpretation in terms of, which is very simple in this example, but has a nice interpretation in terms of contact homology, is the lowest Conley-Zender degree with non-trivial contact homology. For S2n+1. In fact, the contact homology of S2n+1 is well known to be isomorphic to Q if the degree is of the form n+2 plus 2k, where k is any non-negative integer, including 0 and 0 otherwise. Okay. And so it's based on this interpretation of the result of Hofer, Vysotsky, and Zender that we introduced some years ago, some 3 years ago, let's say, but the paper appeared last year. The definition of a definition of dynamical convexity for an arbitrary contact manifold, at least for those for which one can make sense of cylindrical contact homology in a meaningful way, in the following way. So let's call k minus the smallest degree with non-trivial contact homology of some contact manifold M. Let's define K plus, because sometimes it's useful to also look at the greatest degree What am I saying? This is a K. The greatest degree with non-trivial contact homology, and we say that some contact form alpha is, say, positively, dynamically convex if k minus is finite, meaning an integer, it's not plus infinity, and the Conle's and the degree of any closed rib orbit is less than or equal, greater or equal, sorry, than this k minus for all gamma, for all closed rib orbit, for closed orbit gamma of the corresponding rib vector field, and we'll say that is negatively dynamically convex if k plus is an integer and new Collins-Zander is less than or equal than k plus for all closed rib orbits. Okay, so this is the definition. So 2 years ago I spoke of how one could use this definition to generalize some known results about the existence of elliptic orbits. And today, I'll do the same for this multiplicity problem. So, and the main results can be stated in the following way. So we'll be dealing with prequantizations. So our contact manifold, closed contact manifold, will be a prequantization over a closed symplectic, integral symplectic manifold B omega, and we'll assume throughout the following conditions: that the first sham class vanishes on pi 2. We are in the non-aspherical case of the base. And, thank you, and either the minimal Chern number of the base is bigger, strictly greater than n, you'll need that, or we can also deal when this minimal Chern number is equal to n, provided we add some conditions, and what we are dealing, what we've been working with, is the condition that the homology of the base is concentrated in even degrees. So for odd k, it is equal to 0. And we also need that pi 1 of m is torsion-free. That the fiber of this prequantization is contractible. OK, where here CB is the minimal spherical Chern number of the base. So these conditions I will denote by star from now on. Okay? So they will always be present in the result I'm now going to state. What am I saying? Okay, it's going good. I have 10 pages. I did 5, and we are. So,
We're good.
Oh, sorry, okay. But now I have to continue with the same rhythm, sorry. Okay, so the theorem has two parts, kind of mimicking those two. The first is if star in this setup, and probably we also need, or maybe we don't need, so this is being written up, and Leonardo is always improving stuff. So, but for now, let's say that I need the other characteristic of B to be different from zero. It's only relevant in this case. Here it's certainly, because of this condition, certainly different from zero. Maybe we can take that out, but let's keep it like that. Then, any positively or negatively dynamically convex contact form possibly degenerate, so this is a general result, including the degenerate case, alpha, contact form alpha supporting C, has at least two closed reboards. In part B, is the non-degenerate case, and there we don't need, we certainly don't need that other characteristic condition. Then, so we, but we do need star, those conditions star, then any non-degenerate positively or negatively dynamically convex contact form supporting C has at least RB closed periodic orbits where RB is the rank, total rank of the homology of the base, say with Q coefficients. Okay? So these are the two results that certainly seem, at least, we'll see in the examples there are, but seem more general than cover these two cases and possibly more. So here, the base is CPN, and the rank is n plus 1, which is exactly, the rank of the homology of CPN is n plus 1, which is exactly the number we get here. So there are several things we might add to this theorem, but I'll just say one today, a remark, which is in the non-degenerate case, if n and the minimal Chern number are odd, and we know for a fact, for some reason, that there are only finitely many closed rib orbits, then there are at least, so those RB ones that we get are non-hyperbolic. There are at least RB simple non-hyperbolic closed rib orbits. So if for some reason you know that your system has some hyperbolic closed rib orbit, then there will be RB plus 1 because that theorem provides at least RB non-hyperbolic ones. For the moment, I might come back later. So I think now I can erase this. For the moment, let me just say the following words about the proof. I'll come back to it at the end to add just a little bit more, not much more. But the proof uses, in a very strong way, so the ideas of Long and Zhu, in particular, the common index jump theorem. Of Long and Zhu, and also properties for the more delicate aspects of the proof, properties of a strong degenerate maximum people normally denote by an SDM due to Ginzburg, Hein, Hriniewski, did I make it? Guess so. And Macarini, all present in the room. Okay, I'll come back. I think I will have time to come back to say more about the proof. But let me first discuss some applications so that we see that you can indeed generalize that result, put more results under the same umbrella. Applications. So I'll actually just discuss applications of the non-degenerate case. Okay? Theorem. So the first one is a generalization, which was actually had been proved before by Gut and Kang. Curiously, a preprint appeared in the archive today. Very nice result. So generalization of that Long and Zhu's result. So saying that, so the rev flow of any non-degenerate dynamically convex alpha on the odd dimensional sphere with its standard complex structure, contact structure, has at least n plus 1 closed rib orbitals. Okay. Second set of applications. And this set is what motivated the effort to be able to consider minimal Chern number equal to n, and not just strictly greater than n, have to do with geodesic flows on spheres. So, Here, the contact manifold is the cosphere bundle. Over S and to keep my, so that the total thing has dimension 2n plus 1 is the sphere Sn plus 1. This cosphere bundle turns out to be the prequantization of the Grassmannian. So B here is the Grassmannian of oriented two planes in Rn plus 2. So this can be seen as a prequantization. And this B is a symplectic manifold, has Chern number, minimal Chern number n, has satisfies the conditions that its homology in odd degree is zero. It is simply connected. The total space is certainly simply connected. And the rank of the homology of the base, which is the ingredient we need, if I'm not mistaken, with these n's, with these dimensions, is the integer part of n over 2 plus 1. OK? And so one can apply our theorem B and conclude that the rep flow of any non-degenerate dynamically convex alpha on this manifold with its standard contact structure. Standard contact structure coming from the, this is the, an hypersurface in the cotangent bundle of Sn, has at least this number of closed rib orbits. OK? A corollary is an application to Finsler metrics. So this is, was a result proved by Wang, a student of Long, and whose paper also was important in the work I've been presenting today, but says that any bumpy Finsler metric, and bumpy here for me just means that the geodesic flow is non-degenerate, so that it fits this theorem, on Sn plus 1 with reversibility. So there are some numbers associated with the Finsler metric, lambda, reversibility with lambda, and flock curvature k, satisfying. So now we need a condition to guarantee that the geodesic flow is dynamically convex, and that condition comes from an inequality of this type. So anything like this has at least this number of prime closed geodesic, of prime closed geodesics. So I don't know, everybody sees here, right? So remarks that both have been made already in this conference, but let me say them again, because they fit his result. First is that examples due to Katok and Ziller show that this corollary is sharp. And secondly, a conjecture on Anosov's conjecture, say that the corollary should be true for any. For any Fins Lemaître. Any, I believe, bumpy. Leonardo. Maybe any. Maybe any. It should be for any. So this shows how far we are from there, right? So certainly we cannot remove the condition because we need dynamical convexity, and without this condition we don't have dynamical convexity, let alone the bumpy fact. But anyway, at least it puts in the same framework this corollary of Wang. What we can say, but it's, let me just another remark, is that if one looks at theorem B with a simple contradiction argument, one gets that under those conditions star, but without anything else, any non-degenerate, so here here in this statement you don't need to put dynamical convexity, any non-degenerate contact form, has at least two closed Reb orbits, because if it had only one and it was non-degenerate, one gets automatically from those conditions star that it turns out that then it is dynamically convex. So then we could apply the theorem and it needed to have two. So it needs to have at least two. So a corollary of this, which was proved before by Long and another student, I think one, any bumpy. We do need non-degenerate here, right? I wrote it, yeah. Very important. We do need non-degenerate. Any bumpy. I'm losing my rhythm, right? Any bumpy. Finsler. Metric. On Sn plus 1 has at least two periodic orbits, two prime closed geodesics. Without any assumption on the curvature, on the flag curvature, reversibility constant. Okay, 10 minutes. All right. We are good. So before, say something more about the proof, let me just also put here some further questions in this circle of applications and ideas. They are all for pre-quantizations. Of non-aspherical bias. Okay, the first question is the following. Is it true or not that any rev flow without assuming dynamical convexity or anything has either that minimal number of closed rib orbits that the theorem guarantees when dynamically convex, or if there are non-necessary ones, then it necessarily has infinitely many. In the line of questions that, for example, appeared certainly in Victor's talk, in Bashak's talk. Okay? This is unknown even for S3. For S3, where Hofer, Visoki, and Zender conjecture yes, that the answer should be yes. If you add convexity to this question, so if we require this contact form to be dynamically convex, so we also don't know the answer in general, but at least Hofer, Visoki, and Zender say yes for S3. But this is probably the only case of where this dichotomy is known. A third question is the following. Does suppose that the contact form is perfect? Hence, so that means that the boundary of Prater is zero in contact homology. Does this imply that the number is necessarily, the number of closed rib orbit is necessarily the minimum number? So this is also known for S3 by result of Frederic, who is here, Bourgeois, Kai Chilebach, and Tobias Ekholm. They prove that yes for S3. Again, it's probably the only case where it is known. We can say something along these lines, which is the following. Suppose you have some MXC, as in theorem B, non-degenerate contact form, satisfying star, so forth. Then the rep flow of a perfect alpha has the number of even closed rib orbits exactly equal to RB. That we can say. And a closed rib orbit is even if its Conway Zender index and the Condon Zender index of its iterate gamma square have the same parity, either both even or both odd. Okay, that we can prove. And as a remark, this result is an improvement over a previous bound proved by Bashak. Okay. So, last 5 minutes to say something more about the proof. In particular, I will only talk about the non-degenerate case, and let me at least state in the non-degenerate case this common index jump theorem, very powerful machine. Of Langen's. So again, suppose we have some contact manifold with a contact form. And suppose we have R, let R be a set of non-degenerate periodic with positive mean index. Non-degenerate with positive mean index. Let n, big N, be n0, be an arbitrary natural number. Then this theorem says that there exists another natural number, big N, plus natural numbers M1, MR. You'll see where they appear. With this big N can be chosen to be a multiple of that arbitrary N0 that you specified. That will be important, such that, and this has, now this gives a specific bound for the index of iterates of these specific iterates of these R closed Reb orbits. It says that the Cohn-Lenzander index of the 2mi minus 1 iterate of the orbit gamma I is equal to 2 big N minus the Cohn-Lenzander index of its first iterate for all I equal to 1 to r. Second, and you'll see, I'll just make a drawing that will show how these kind of almost proofs. That's it. First, then, the next iterate has for sure Cohn-Lenzander index in between these two big N minus little n. Little n is this dimension. And two big N plus little n. And the next iterate So the iterate m2mi plus 1 has Cohn-Lenzander index exactly equal to 2 big N plus the Cohn-Lenzander index of gamma I. So this is the one minute for one picture. But I need to make two pictures, so it will be 1 minute over time. Let me erase the whole thing. So let me now think of the theorem B, and the case where we know that the Chern number is greater or equal than n plus 1, which is the easiest case. So let me draw here a line representing kind of the degrees of contact homology. And here the number star, where the degree is. Well, this big N, if one chooses this N0 carefully, this big N is a multiple of N0. And let me look here at the window of degrees, 2N minus N, growing. 2 big N growing 2N plus N. It turns out that the contact homology for this prequantization tells us that above here you have exactly a copy of the homology of the base. So you have H0. Here you have middle homology of the base. And here you have top homology of the base. And that's it. That's it. And then you have copies of these, but they don't overlap. So that's the homology you have. So here, just in this range, you have rank exactly equal to RB, the rank of contact moments. On the other hand, who are the orbits that can contribute to this range? So the common index sum theorem tells us that if you only have R rev orbits, non-degenerate, blah, 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 what happens? Well, certainly, the way I set up, you have the gamma I to the 2mi. So you have one for each R. And now what happens to the rest? The previous iterate has degree equal to 2n minus the Collins-Ender index of gamma I. But because we are assuming dynamical convexity and this hypothesis on a prequantization, this is always greater or equal than n plus 1. So this is below here. So the gamma i's to the 2mi minus 1, all of them are outside this range. And the next one, that's why this is called the common index jump, they were here, all of them jump inside, and after that, all of them jump outside. That's it. So in this case, you automatically get that this R, which is the number of orbits, has to at least cover the whole contact moment. OK, now I'll finish here. I will have to say something more if the first number of was n. But this theorem also says more than what I'm saying. There is a lot of things that you can do with this, but it's a marvelous machine. And when you're working with Leonardo, you get marvelous results, at least I think. I'm very happy for this. Thank you very much.